بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وحبيب إله العالمين، العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الهداة المهديين. Illuminate your majalis and your hearts with a loud salawat for Muhammad and Al Muhammad. Respected brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We mentioned last night that in the same way our bodies can get sick, can be afflicted with viruses, diseases, and sicknesses, the souls that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, our soul, our spirit, our heart, as the Quran calls the soul, can also be afflicted with disease and illnesses. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in various verses in the Quran. We mentioned some of them. The first example that we went over, that the Quran highlights and mentions a particular type of spiritual disease and sickness, maradul qalb, when our hearts, our souls become sick, was the example of hypocrisy, nifaq. And we said that hypocrisy can come in three different forms: hypocrisy in belief, hypocrisy in our deeds, and hypocrisy in our conduct. And we spoke about that. Allah Azza wa Jal considers this as a spiritual disorder because it is similar to bipolar disease, how you have two faces, you have two personalities. A hypocrite has two faces and two personalities, and that's why it is considered as a disorder. But a spiritual disorder, a disorder that afflicts the soul, the heart, rather than the body and the mind. Let's continue and mention some more examples that the Quran mentions of how the soul can become struck with disease, afflicted with disease, how the heart can become sick, so we can be careful and take our precautionary measures not to be afflicted by these diseases. The second example is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran. He mentions it in Surah Al-Ahzab, verse 32. In this verse, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions some of the ahkam of hijab, of modesty. The goal of the physical hijab is to promote modesty between the opposite genders, between a man and a woman. And that's why the word hijab, if you ever look, you want to search for hijab in the Quran, you may not find it in the way that you want, because hijab in Arabic means barrier. It doesn't mean the scarf that sisters wear. Hijab means barrier. That's why we see in Dua Abu Hamza Thamali, Imam Zainul Abideen says that sometimes there is a hijab between us and Allah. And that hijab is our sins. It is a barrier between us and Allah Azza wa Jal. So hijab just means barrier. You're just creating some room between the opposite genders to promote modesty. So Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the laws of hijab in the Quran. And he shows us that there's two types of hijab. The first is the physical hijab. And this is the hijab that we usually understand. That's the physical cover that Allah Azza wa Jal orders Muslim woman to maintain, the dress code. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions this in Surah An-Nur. وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ. And tell the believing woman to lower their gaze and guard their chastity. And then the Quran says, وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جِيُوبِهِنَّ. Allah Azza wa Jal says two things regarding the physical hijab. Tell the believing woman, number one, to not show their beauty. They have to conceal their beauty from men that are not mahram. Mahram is your father, your son, your brother, your uncle, nephew, grandfather. If it's not that, and it's a male, a woman has to conceal her beauty. She has to conceal her body from all men. But the Quran makes one exception. Illa ma dhahara minha. They have to cover the entire body except the apparent beauty. Now, what is the apparent beauty? This is amongst the allegorical and ambiguous verses, meaning the Quran doesn't make it clear. Anytime the Quran does not make something clear and it's vague and it can be subject to interpretation, what do? The Quran teaches us. We have to go back to Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salatu wassalam. Al-rasikhuna fil ilm, as the verse in Surah Al-Imran mentions. And when we go back to Ahlul Bayt, the Ahlul Bayt tell us that the entire body of a woman, Muslim woman, has to be covered except the face and the hands, because that is the apparent beauty. So that's one part of this verse, that's the physical hijab. And then right after that, Allah mentions the scarf, the head, the veil. وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُوبِهِنَّ. And then they have to wear the khimar. Khimar is this hijab that we call. Hijab means barrier. If you're looking for the word that matches the headscarf, it's khimar. And Allah mentions that. And they have to make sure that they wear their hijab, that they wear their khimars all the way to their chest. Yani, they have to bring it close to their head and over their chest. So Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the physical hijab in this verse. But hijab, brothers and sisters, is not just the physical aspect. That's only half of hijab. There's also the social hijab. What do we mean social hijab? How someone conducts themselves. My behavior, my speech, the way I talk, my tone, how I speak to others, and how I walk, all my behavior, this has to always be modest in front of the opposite gender. And this second aspect of hijab, the social hijab, does not pertain to women only. Women and men. Allah Azza wa Jal says that you have to be modest in your dressing. You have to be modest in your dress and in your conduct. That's why when Allah begins to speak about the laws of hijab, He begins with men. Allah says, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Tell the believers to lower their gaze. When you see something that is inappropriate, you have to lower your head. You have to lower your gaze. Do not look. This is a part of hijab. Yes, this is a part of modesty. And Allah mentions the same thing for sisters, for women. But in addition, there is the physical hijab. Now, in this verse that I mentioned, Surah Al-Ahzab, verse 32, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions one of the ahkam, one of the laws of the social hijab, meaning our behavior. Allah Azza wa Jal says, Ya Nisa al-Nabi, لَسْتُنَّ كَأَحَدٍ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. Allah addresses the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. He tells them, O wives of Rasulullah, of the Messenger, of the Prophet, لَسْتُنَّ كَأَحَدٍ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. You are not like other women. You hold a very high and prominent position. You're the wives of the Prophet of Allah. So then Allah Azza wa Jal tells them what they have to do. إن اتقيتن فلا تخضعن بالقول. Allah tells them, if you fear Allah Azza wa Jal, then you have to be mindful of your tone in front of other men. And Allah gives them an explicit commandment. Allah says, do not soften your voice in front of men. You see, sometimes a woman is able to soften her voice in a way that is tempting to the opposite gender. Remember once a brother told me, he was telling me, we were having this discussion on hijab and the social hijab. And he said, my sister, he was talking about his sister, when she speaks to random other men, her voice is so soft. Sounds like a squirrel, like a chipmunk sometimes. But when she talks to me at home, she sounds like a bear. Or when she talks to my father and mother. What's going on? Sometimes some sisters unconsciously do that, where the voice softens, but not in a modest way, in an immodest way. The Quran says, beware of even your tone when you speak to other men. Now someone may say, why? What's the big deal, right? Just my voice. What damage can it do? Wrong. Allah tells you to be what? To be realistic. Allah Azza wa Jal says, فَلَا تَغْضَعْنَ بِالْقَوْلِ فَيَطْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٍ. Allah Azza wa Jal says, maybe you don't have any bad intentions when you soften your voice in front of men. But Allah says, but know that amongst men, in general in the world, there are some who in their hearts there is sickness. Their hearts are sick. Their hearts are afflicted with disease. So maybe you don't mean anything from that soft voice. You're not trying to signal anything. But that individual, because of that sickness of the heart, of the soul, they will get the wrong message. They will misinterpret that soft voice. Oh, her voice is soft. That means she's probably sending me a message. Maybe she wants to go out with me. And no, it's something completely normal that the sister is doing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, be extra sensitive. Because you may have good intentions, but not everyone is like you. Not everyone has good intentions. And what's interesting, brothers and sisters, about this verse is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considers those men that cannot control their desire, their intimate desire. Those men that cannot lower their gaze, that cannot look the other way, that cannot control their desire and discipline themselves, Allah considers these individuals as being diseased. Their hearts are diseased. Let's say a woman did something wrong. She wore inappropriate and immodestly. She spoke in an immodest way. Now Allah Azza wa Jal obviously will hold that person accountable. But Allah Azza wa Jal says that you as a man have a responsibility to what? To do jihadun nafs. Tell yourself no. Look the other way. If you don't, if you cannot control that desire, the Quran says then there is sickness and disease in your qalb, in your soul, in your heart. فَيَطْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٍ. The one who is tempted by the soft voice, and not just tempted, but also act upon. You see, being tempted is one thing. The human being has natural temptations, and that's fine. But following those temptations and acting on those temptations is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draws the line. Allah says, I gave you intellect. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I gave you free will. Where's jihadun nafs? Where's the resistance that you're able to do, patience and resistance? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if someone is not able to resist, when they see something, they just have to stare. This person, in their heart, there is a disease, it's a sickness. When they hear, they're walking, and all of a sudden they hear a soft voice of a sister, they have to right away look to the side, see what is it. The Quran says you have a problem in your heart and soul. You have to discipline yourself. You have to seek treatment in order to be able to control this desire. So this is another example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Holy Quran of a type of disease that can afflict the soul. And unfortunately now you see it's so pervasive and rampant in society that there's no such thing as lowering your gaze anymore. If you find someone that lowers their gaze in front of the opposite gender, you find that, first of all, it's rare. And if you do see someone like that, people will even be confused. Why doesn't he look? Why doesn't he look at that person in their eyes when he speaks to them or when she speaks to him? What's the issue? Because it's become so rare that we do not even understand the value of this virtue anymore. That Allah orders men and women, when you walk, lower your gaze. When you see something inappropriate, lower your gaze. They're doing something haram. Maybe they're doing it intentionally, unintentionally. I don't care. My responsibility is to lower my gaze. My responsibility is to look the other side. That's why the famous hadith, it's mentioned by the Prophet, by more than one imam. The first look is for you. Meaning, it's okay. Allah Azza wa Jalla will forgive you because the first look, you may not know what's there. But the second look is against you. So let's say you're just looking and then you see something. What happens? You see it once, but then you go back, you quickly turn your head again. That second turn is where Allah will hold you. So the first one, you didn't know what was there. So that's fine. Move your head. Don't look again. If you do look again, then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, then you have a problem in your heart. You have a disorder, a sickness. And because of this disorder, you can't help but look. So this is the second example of sickness of the soul that Allah mentions in the Holy Quran. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Third example of maradul qalb, sickness of the heart and the soul that Allah highlights in the Holy Quran, is when we human beings lose our moral compass. When our moral compass breaks, the Quran considers this as a disorder. But it's a spiritual disorder. It's a disorder that afflicts the soul, the ruh, the heart. The Quran says, أَفَمَنْ زُيِّنَ لَهُ سُوءُ عَمَلِهِ فَرَآهُ حَسَنًا. There are some individuals, their moral compass breaks. And because it breaks, they start seeing evil as good and good as evil. They're not just doing evil because they don't care. I don't care about being evil. No, they do evil thinking, they really think that they're doing something good. And they will refrain from something that is good, thinking that it's evil. This, the Quran says, is a disease of the heart. It's a spiritual disorder. It's similar to schizophrenia. Why? Because you live in a delusional world where you can't see the reality of things. Good things are bad and bad things are good. Let me give you a couple examples, and there's so many examples today in society. And every year, we're seeing newer examples of how this disorder, this spiritual disorder, is becoming worse and worse and more rampant. Same gender attraction, homosexuality. If someone, a human being, is attracted to the same gender, what do we call this? This, in reality, is a disorder. It's a psychological disorder. And by the way, it was considered a psychological disorder until a couple of decades ago when the lobbyists, the gay movement lobbyists, they pressured the world of psychology and psychiatry in order to remove it from disorders. So it's no longer something abnormal. It's no longer a disorder. But being attracted to the same gender is a disorder. It's a psychological disorder. It's a mental disorder. That means there's a problem in my body, in my mind. I'm not supposed to. by design, I'm not supposed to be attracted to the same gender. Now, usually what you'll hear today is, well, what if someone is born with that desire? They're attracted to the same gender. So what? That does not mean it's no longer a disorder. Some people are born with disorders. There's hundreds of disorders that everybody accepts. They are disorders, but you'll find children are born with it. Does that mean if you're born with something, it's not a disorder? No. I never chose to be attracted. I never chose to be gay. Okay, you never chose that. But that does not mean it's not a disorder. People who are born disabled never chose to be disabled, but they're still disabled. There are people who have all these weird types of disorders, and they're born with it. Does that mean it's not a disorder? No. Being born with something or it develops later has nothing to do with it being normal or it being a disorder. Or else, if the rule and the standard is whatever you are born with is okay, it's normal, it's moral, then why do we find that our society stigmatizes pedophiles? There are some people with this specific attraction towards children. They're called pedophiles, right? Why are they stigmatized? I was born with it. I never chose to be attracted to children. Why are they stigmatized? Why is that seen as being immoral? Why? There's no answer. It all goes back to our desire. Whatever we like is a disorder, and whatever we don't want to consider as a disorder is not a disorder. You'll even find when you read about disorders, there's a disorder called masochism. And that's when someone loves being humiliated and pain through that intimate desire. This is considered as a disorder. They put it under the different, why? Well, I was born with loving humiliation and pain. What's the problem with that? Just being born with an inclination, with a desire, does not make it normal, brothers and sisters. This is the biggest fallacy that is used today. I was born with it. Who am I hurting? If you're hurting someone or you're not hurting someone, that is not the definition of what a disorder is. There are so many people that have disorders, and are they hurting anybody? Why do we consider those as disorders? Why? Because that is not normal. Because this is an abnormality that should not happen in a healthy body and healthy mind. Now, being attracted to the same gender, or as we call homosexuality, if someone has this urge, and this is a topic, brothers and sisters, that we shouldn't shy away from. Some people are uncomfortable in the masjid if we talk about this. But as soon as you leave those doors, it's not just being talked about. It's being shoved down our throats. It's everywhere on social media and media. So it doesn't make sense to put our heads under the table or under the rug and pretend as if these problems don't exist. I get calls, brothers and sisters, from people in our community who tell me that I am struggling with this desire. From parents who find out that their children are struggling from the... It's not a surprise. Yes, it's disappointing, but it shouldn't be a surprise because it's become so pervasive. Why should I think that our community is immune to this? No. Our community lives in this country just like all other communities. And definitely these immoral and liberal ideals and ideologies, they will start penetrating even our own communities. So we have to protect ourselves. We have to protect ourselves physically, morally, and spiritually. If someone has that urge, meaning they find themselves attracted to the same desire, what does that mean? Is that a sin? Listen carefully, please. Do not distort my words and do not take them out of context. Let me finish the entire paragraph, then you can start objecting. If someone has these urges, is that a sin? Does that mean Allah hates them? Allah hates them? Absolutely not. If someone feels that they are attracted to the same gender, you know what that means? It means they have a disorder. Just like pedophile, just like masochism and all, hundreds of other disorders. This is a disorder that Allah has afflicted with. And it doesn't mean that Allah hates me. Why? Because this is life, this is dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to test me with so many different ways. Physical disorders, physical diseases, mental disorders. There's all sorts of problems in this life. So if someone finds that they have this urge, what do they have to do? They just have to practice jihadun nafs. They have to fight this urge and resist it, just like any other immoral urge that we have. Doesn't the Quran say that if you don't lower your gaze, and if you are tempted by a woman's soft voice and you cannot look away, you have a disease in your heart? This is a disorder? If someone is attracted to the same gender, this is a disorder. But that doesn't mean this person is evil. Doesn't mean this is a sin, because it's just a feeling. Feelings cannot be described as haram or halal. Only acts can be described as halal and haram. When does it become a sin? When someone acts upon that feeling. When the feeling is expressed and translated into action, this is where Allah Azza wa Jal writes halal and haram. This is when it becomes a sin. So on the day of judgment, if Allah holds someone accountable for acting upon this feeling, it's never an excuse to say, well, I had this urge, so what? I have an urge to rob a bank. I could just go rob a bank. Having an urge and a desire doesn't mean you have to follow it. That means I'm an animal. Animals follow whatever desires that comes across their mind. A human being has desires and has intellect. And his intellect is supposed to teach him which desires to follow and which to say no. When I see that basket being carried, maybe I have this desire just to put my hand and put it in my pocket. It's not my fault. It's just a desire in my heart. That means I can act upon whatever desire that I have. I see someone driving an expensive car. I have a desire to have that car. Let me just go steal it. Since one is having a desire, an excuse. So Allah will tell me, you had the desire. I tested you with it. But you had free will and intellect. You could have said no. Don't tell me you couldn't say no. Don't tell me that you were forced to do this. No. This is what life is about. It's about patience and jihad and nafs. So when someone acts upon this desire and urge, this is when it becomes a sin. Now, that's not the worst of it. Because when someone acts upon this desire, or any bad desire, any abnormal desire, and they commit that sin, they can always repent. The door of repentance never closes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ghaffarul dhunub. No matter how big my sin is, no matter what I did, I truly repent and I stop, Allah will forgive me. So acting upon that desire is a sin, but it's not the end of the world. Because what? Because you can repent to Allah just like any other sin. But do you know what is a travesty? Do you know what makes this a serious spiritual disease? It's when I start to normalize this desire and think that it's okay, it's not a disorder. That's the problem. The problem isn't with just having the desire. And really, it is a problem, but it's not as big when someone acts upon it privately but knows that they're doing something wrong and they feel guilty about it and they wish to repent one day. That is good, that sense of guilt. With every sin, if there's guilt, that will lead me to repent. It's not a big deal. It's a haram, it's a sin, but there's a way out of it. But the greatest sin or problem is when you commit the sin and you don't believe it's a sin. And this is what the Quran says. أَفَمَنْ زُيِّنَ لَهُ سُوءُ عَمَلِهِ فَرَآهُ حَسَنًا. Not only does he commit the evil act, but he sees it as good. He sees it as, this is my right. I have the right to act upon this desire. I have the right to marry someone. And this is normal, moral, and no one has the right to tell me otherwise. This is a disease. A disease that afflicts the heart. And it's a very, very difficult disease to get rid of. Because if you do not acknowledge your mistake, if you do not acknowledge that it's wrong, why would you ever repent? Why would you ever change? And that's why, brothers and sisters, as a general law, never stigmatize someone who is struggling with a sin, no matter what that sin is. As long as they accept it's a sin and they're trying, so they may not successfully be able to get rid of that sin, but as long as they're trying, that's good. We're human beings. We make mistakes, but we're supposed to repent. So do not stigmatize someone as long as they accept it's a sin. And it shouldn't be talked about. And it's kept private. And I'm trying to stop it. Because every single one of us commits sins. Who's a ma'soom here? Who's a ma'soom here? Nobody. We all commit sins. But we acknowledge that they're sins and we try to repent. The problem where we draw the line with these individuals is when they no longer acknowledge it's a sin. And they want us to accept it. No. This is my red line. This is where I'm sorry. I cannot accept this anymore. Because now you're playing with morality. You're trying to change the notion of good and evil. And if people no longer acknowledge evil and good for what it is, right and wrong, then nothing makes sense in this world. So this is one example of when the heart becomes diseased. It's when you no longer acknowledge your sins. When you longer see evil for what it is. Another example from the same category is you can see right now the gender movement, right? Transgender and people that are labeling themselves with all these different genders. When a man, a biological man, feels like a woman, is that bad? What did we just say? Not necessarily. It's a disorder. A man feels like they're a woman. That's a disorder. There's something, there's an imbalance somewhere in their body, in their brain. It's a disorder if a man feels like a woman or a woman feels like a man. It's a disorder. When does it become a spiritual disease and problematic? When you start lying to yourself and telling yourself that I am really a man. And you're not a man. I'm really a woman and you're not a woman. And everybody has to accept that. See the difference? Someone can feel all these different sorts of feelings. I could feel like I'm a rabbit one day. I can feel like I'm a car. Whatever. Who cares how you feel? It's a disorder. But when you consider that as normal and everybody has to accept it, This is when it comes a spiritual disease. Because now you're playing with morality. Now you're playing with the laws of Allah Azza wa Jal. Because Allah has laws that are specific to gender. And if you can easily just switch gender based on how you feel, then that means the laws of Allah make no sense. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give laws that are dependent on the gender if you can easily just change your gender? Or if you don't even believe in gender, you don't have a gender, or you create all these new genders. Last time I checked, there was more than 100 types of gender. If it's just something imaginary in your brain, who cares? Consider yourself whatever. But when you act upon it, this is when it becomes problematic. This is when it becomes a spiritual disorder. You know, I was reading about some unusual disorders that can afflict the human beings. There's a disorder called the walking corpse syndrome. Who's heard of that? Dr. Haidar, at least you. Come on. Weren't paying attention. That's cool. Walking corpse syndrome. It has another more technical name. This is a disorder. When someone faces this disorder, you know what happens to them? They're like transgender people. They think that they're dead. They truly believe that they're dead, but they're alive. But they identify as being dead. Or sometimes they think it's, I know some might be laughing, but it's a real disorder. And some of them really believe that they're not, I mean, it's not like they're trying to fool someone. It's a disorder, like schizophrenia. They're dead, they're alive, but they think they're dead. And you can't convince them otherwise because there's a problem, mental disorder. Or they think they are missing some organs, vital organs. I've read some articles where someone goes to the doctor, what's the problem? I don't have a heart. I'm missing a heart. What do you mean you don't have a heart? So doctors will dismiss it right away, thinking this person is either crazy or they're playing a joke, but they have a disorder. So they'll have to do an x-ray or whatever. They show them, no, that's not my heart. This is probably photoshopped, right? You can't convince them that they have a heart, that they have a liver. I don't have hands, and the hands are there. These are disorders, brothers and sisters. It doesn't mean that you're a bad person. It doesn't mean that this is a sin. It's a disorder. But you have to try your best to acknowledge that this is a disorder. Do not submit to it. If someone feels like they're not a man or not a woman, meaning different than how biologically they were born, that's a disorder. It could be a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you have to fight that urge. If you fight that urge, asan, that disorder could elevate your status on the Day of Judgment. The fact that you had these urges and these weird feelings and you thought you were a woman when you're a man, but if you fight it and do jihad in nafs, that disorder could be the reason why Allah elevates your status on the Day of Judgment. Because Allah gave you a difficult test by afflicting you with that disorder. But you had the patience and the resilience and the wisdom to say no, to think with your intellect, and to fight this urge. So this is a type of spiritual disease, a disease that afflicts the heart, brothers and sisters, that the Quran speaks about. Anytime when morality starts shifting, and this is happening every single day. Every single day there's new things that used to be immoral are being considered as moral. And things that were considered as good are no longer valued in society, like modesty. Modesty doesn't have much value today in this society. I mean, in the US and the liberal Western society anymore. Doesn't have too much. How many times you see people are praised for being modest in their clothing, in their demeanor, in their behavior? It's no longer a value. So this is the third example of a disease that can afflict the heart. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And finally, there's a lot, but this is the last one I'll mention. The fourth example of a spiritual disease, of a disease or sickness that can afflict the heart is qaswatul qalb. This is mentioned in numerous verses in the Quran, and this is amongst the worst illnesses that can afflict the heart. And Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, in one verse speaks about this, in one hadith. He says, "Inna lillah uqubat fil qulubi wal abdan." He says that there are sicknesses that can afflict the body and the heart. And we said the heart means what? The spiritual heart, your spirit and soul. We know what the physical sicknesses are. What are some of those spiritual sicknesses? How does your heart become diseased and ill, but spiritually, not physically? The Imam says, "Dhanakun fil ma'isha." Dhanakun fil ma'isha is extracted from a verse in the Holy Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Waman ya'shu an," Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever forgets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and does not remember Allah, and Allah is not part of their life, فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. Allah Azza wa Jal will afflict them with a spiritual disorder, with a problem. And that's when people feel emptiness inside, void. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not part of your life, Allah says that know that there will be a time in which you will start feeling this emptiness inside you. You'll start feeling this discomfort that cannot be explained by any doctor or physician. That comes from the absence of Allah in your heart and in your life. The other example he mentions, وَوَهْنٌ فِي الْعِبَادَةِ. وَهْنٌ فِي الْعِبَادَةِ is when worship becomes a burden. There are some things that are naturally, we human beings enjoy them naturally. There's pleasure in them. Good food, right? If someone is offered good food and they're healthy, they will enjoy that food, that meal. But if you're sick, if your body is sick, sometimes the best meal on earth, they'll bring you the best steak from the best restaurant. That's medium, rare, whatever you like it, right? And it tastes horrible for you. Why? Is there a problem in that steak? No. And you're not a vegetarian or a vegan or whatever. The problem is you're sick. There's a problem with your body. Your body does not enjoy the natural pleasures of this dunya. And it can happen to every type of desire and pleasure where you don't enjoy it anymore. This is a sickness, you seek treatment. And Imam al-Baqir says, one way our hearts and souls become sick, you know what's one of the symptoms? You want to look for symptoms of your heart being sick, your soul being unhealthy, is when salah is boring, when salah is a burden, when dua is a burden and it's boring and you don't like it. When conversating with Allah is a burden, just know that your soul is sick. Just like your body could get a flu and you won't enjoy foods. So you have to seek treatment for your soul. Because naturally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the soul. It should enjoy ibadah. It should enjoy speaking to Allah, reciting the Quran, doing good deeds. We should get pleasure from this. Obviously, it's not physical pleasure. It's also a different form of pleasure, spiritual pleasure. And that's why when you look at Ahlul Bayt, look at the Prophet. He was asked, what do you love from the dunya the most? He said, Salah. Don't think that Salah is like a chore for the Prophet. For us, it's a chore. It's just something that we have to get over with. Yallah, it's Salah time. Let me go pray and then I'll do what I... No, it was Rasulullah's love and passion. He used to love Salah. Al-Imam al-Hussein on the night of Ashura, you know what he told his companions? He told his brother Abu al-Fadl Abbas, go and tell the enemies, this was the night of Ashura. Let them give us one more day. Yani let us spend this night without fighting and then they can start the fight tomorrow. Let them just give us one night. Why? Look at the answer of the Imam. So I can spend time with my family, so I can enjoy this dunya. He says, so I can spend the night praying to Allah Azza wa Jal. I want to pray Salatul Layl. And then he says, for Allah knows that I love Salah. I enjoy Salah like you and I enjoy a good meal or watching sports or watching a movie. It's entertainment for the Imam, but it's spiritual entertainment. There is nothing that gives joy to Al-Imam Al-Hussein, to Amir Al-Mu'mineen, to Rasulullah, and not just them, to pious individuals who have what? Who have kept their souls healthy. So if I realize that I don't enjoy these, any type of good deed, sometimes you will not enjoy some good deeds because you're not understanding the philosophy or you don't know what you're saying. But if you don't enjoy doing all good deeds, that means you're unhealthy. It's like someone hates walking. To some people, when they're not fit, tell them to walk for 20 feet, after 20 feet, what does that tell you? They're unfit. Get in shape. You're not supposed to be that tired after 20 feet. Yes, if you prayed for 3 hours, you should feel bored and tired. But Salat al-Dhuhr and Asr, 8 rak'ahs. Salat al-Maghrib, 7 rak'ahs, which takes you 7 minutes, you're already tired and bored. That means your soul, your spirit is not healthy. It's not in shape. You have to get it in shape. And why does that happen, brothers and sisters? One reason why this happens is when our hearts harden. The hadith of the Imam, he continues. Remember, he mentioned some of the diseases of the heart, the spiritual heart. He says, وَمَا ضُرِبَ عَبْدٌ بِعُقُوبَ أَعْظَمْ مِنْ قَسْوَةِ الْقُلُوبِ. And one of the worst sicknesses of the heart is when your heart becomes hard. And when we say your heart becomes hard, we don't mean it physically. It doesn't mean that your veins have become hard and that's why blood can't go through it. No. That's the physical illness. The spiritual illness is when your spiritual heart becomes hard. When you're born, Allah gives you a soft heart. And one of the effects of having a soft heart is that you enjoy worship. Is that you connect with the signs of Allah easily. When you see the truth, it penetrates your heart. When you are told an inspirational or motivational story, it moves you. Why? Because that word, that story, that example can penetrate your heart because it's soft. But what happens when your heart is hard? And by hard, we mean it, obviously, symbolically. Nothing will penetrate your heart. Even if you see Al-Imam Al-Mahdi, عجل الله فرجه الشريف, and the beautiful nur of his face, you'll still go back to haram. You'll still go back to sin. Why? Because that nur of the Imam can't penetrate your heart because your heart is hard. It can't pass. Just like when the blood cannot pass through your veins and you get a heart attack. Why does the heart become hard? One of the main reasons that our hearts become hard and it's hard for us to enjoy worship, dua, salah. We're not easily affected and moved by the examples of the Quran and the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt is because of the sins that we do, brothers and sisters. In the hadith, Al-Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam says, مَا قَسَتِ الْقُلُوبِ قَسْوَةُ الْقَلْبِ. When your heart hardens, إِلَّا لِكَثْرَةِ الذُّنُوبِ. Every time you sin, your heart, it starts becoming a bit harder. You sin again and again and again, it gets harder and harder until your entire heart is blocked off. When that happens, nothing will affect you. And Allah mentions this in the Holy Quran. كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا. Some individuals, they were never affected by the Prophet. They were never guided by the Prophet. Mountains would humble before the Prophet. But some individuals, no. What's the problem with them? Because their sins have completely dominated their hearts. It's created their sins a layer, a barrier. Thus, nothing can penetrate. And when that happens, brothers and sisters, you just start drowning deeper in sins and in misguidance. And nothing can save you. There are some people, nothing can save them. No matter how many lectures, how much you speak to them nicely, aggressively, whatever you do, there's just no point. Why? Because the passageway is blocked. This is one of the worst spiritual diseases that may obstruct us. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to soften your heart. And there are certain treatments, there are certain ways for us to heal our hearts, brothers and sisters, to soften our hearts. This, inshallah, I will mention tomorrow night. And this is very important. We will end, inshallah, by this series. How do we keep ourselves immune from these spiritual diseases? How do I keep a healthy heart such that the Quran says, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ. On the day of judgment, nothing will help you. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Except the one that comes with a pure and healthy heart. How do we purify our hearts and make it healthy such that we have that qalb al-salim on the day of judgment, inshallah, we will mention some of the prescriptions and the guidelines mentioned in the Holy Quran and by the Ahlul Bayt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all and accept your a'mal. Inshallah, Monday night, we will be having the celebration of the birthday of Al-Imam Al-Hasan Al-Mushtaba alayhi salam. So, inshallah, we invite you all. Tomorrow we'll have the program normally, but Monday night we will have the celebration. We'll have some sweets and candy, and we will have, inshallah, a reciter who will recite poetry, inshallah, for Imam Al-Hasan. May Allah accept all your a'mal, forgive us of all our deeds, give us the tawfiq and the ability that we are able to purify our hearts during the month of Ramadan.